Hello viewers, today we are going to study about hemostasis. Hemostasis can be simply defined as the process of formation of blood clot at the site of vascular injury, and it involves platelets, coagulation factors and endothelium. So hemostasis is deranged in a variety of disorders which can be categorized into two categories, hemorrhagic disorders and thrombotic disorders. So in hemorrhagic disorders, the hemostasis is insufficient to prevent blood loss or hemorrhage. Whereas in case of thrombotic disorders, there is abnormal formation of blood clot within intact vessels or within the chambers of the heart. And another entity is DIC, disseminated intravascular coagulation, in which there is paradoxical hemorrhage because of excessive consumption of clotting factors. There is excessive activation of clotting which leads to consumption coagulopathy, and there is hemorrhage. So in this entity, both hemorrhage and thrombosis are seen. So what are the steps in hemostasis? First is vasoconstriction. So after vascular injury, there is immediate transient arteriolar vasoconstriction, and this is mediated by reflex neurogenic mechanism, and also by endothelin release from the endothelium. This is a vasoconstrictor. This is a potent vasoconstrictor, and this reduces the flow of blood to the site of injury. But this is not sufficient to prevent the loss of blood if the primary hemostatic plug formation and coagulation activation doesn't occur. Bleeding will not stop. Next is primary hemostasis, or the formation of platelet plug. Now the vascular injury exposes the subendothelial von Willebrand factor and collagen, and platelets adhere to von Willebrand factor and collagen, and this leads to change in shape. This leads to activation. The change in shape and granule release is called as activation. So activation of platelets occurs. So the shape of platelet is round, disc like, and then it becomes flat, plate like. So the surface area of platelet increases, and there is release of the substances from alpha granules and the delta granules, which further activate the platelets and lead to recruitment of additional platelets. So additional platelets they recruit, and this leads to aggregation of platelets at the site of injury, and this leads to the formation of hemostatic plug. Next step is secondary hemostasis. Here the deposition of fibrin occurs, fibrin deposition. So at the site of injury, the tissue factor is released, and this tissue factor is expressed by subendothelial fibroblasts and smooth muscle cells. So they release tissue factor. So this tissue factor, it activates factor 7. It activates factor 7 and forms a complex which leads to the activation of the coagulation cascade. So there is formation of thrombin. With the activation of coagulation cascade, there is formation of thrombin. This thrombin performs two functions. It cleaves fibrinogen and forms fibrin. So it forms fibrin. And second, it activates the platelets. So the activated platelets, they aggregate. There is further aggregation of platelets, and this leads to formation of secondary hemostatic plug. So there is further activation of platelets and aggregation of platelets, and this fibrin, it gets deposited, and it consolidates the primary platelet plug, and this leads to the formation of secondary hemostatic plug. Here the phospholipid coagulation factor complex, these phospholipids, these are expressed by the activated platelets, and they form a nucleation site for the coagulation factor complex formation. And this then the thrombin activation occurs, then fibrin polymerization occurs. Now the next step is clot stabilization and resorption. So the polymerized fibrin or the fibrin meshwork and the platelets, they contract to form a solid permanent plug. They form a solid permanent plug. And at this point, the counter-regulatory mechanisms come into play. There is release of tissue plasminogen activator, which leads to fibrinolysis, and thrombomodulin, which blocks the coagulation cascade. So these counter-regulatory mechanisms, they limit the size of clot, and they also ensure that the hemostatic process, it occurs only at the site of vascular injury. So thus hemostasis, it not only involves the processes which lead to clot formation, but it also involves the mechanisms which lead to resorption of clot and which limits the clot formation. So we can say that hemostasis ensures that the blood is in fluid clot-free state in normal vessels, and by hemostasis there is formation of rapid and localized clot formation or the hemostatic plug formation at the site of vascular injury. Now we study about the role of platelets in hemostasis. What is the role of platelets in hemostasis? So platelets play important role in hemostasis. They form primary hemostatic plug, and they also provide a surface for assembly of coagulation, activated coagulation factors. So the function of platelets depends on the platelets have glycoprotein receptors, they have contractile cytoskeleton, and they have cytoplasmic granules, alpha granules and dense granules. Basically the platelets, they are anucleate cellular fragments that are derived from megakaryocytes in the bone marrow, and these fragments, they are shed in the bloodstream. From the bone marrow they come in the bloodstream, and in the alpha granules the granules have p-selectin and also the factors which are important for coagulation: fibrinogen, factor 5, von Willebrand factor, and also certain proteins which are required in wound healing, the fibronectin, platelet factor 4, platelet derived growth factor, transforming growth factor beta, and the dense granules or the delta granules, they have ADP, ATP, ionized calcium, serotonin, epinephrine. Now what happens when there is vascular injury? The platelets, they encounter the von Willebrand factor and collagen. So first step is platelet adhesion. And this is mediated by glycoprotein receptor 1B, which binds to von Willebrand factor. So by this way, the platelets adhere to the this subendothelium. The glycoprotein 1A, 2A, they bind to the exposed collagen. Second step is shape change. Normally the platelets, they are round disc-like structures. When they are activated, in activation we include the shape change and the granule release. So they become plate-like, flat plate-like with spikes on the surface to increase the surface area. And this shape change, this is accompanied by conformational changes in glycoprotein 2B, 3A. And by this change, there is increased affinity for fibrinogen. fibrinogen. So this glycoprotein 2B3A, it binds to fibrinogen and this acts as a bridge between two platelets. So this helps in platelet aggregation. And also in shape change, there is translocation of negatively charged phospholipids towards the outer surface of platelets, and these then bind to calcium and they act as nucleation site for assembly of clotting factor complexes. Next is granule release. So shape change and granule release, these are called as activation of platelets. And this activation is mediated by thrombin and ADP. ADP is present in the delta granules. It is present in the delta granules. So thrombin not only converts fibrinogen to fibrin, this fibrin, it acts as a cementing material, or it converts the primary hemostatic plug into secondary hemostatic plug. It acts as a cementing material between the platelets. But it also activates platelets through protease activated receptors. These are PAR1 G protein coupled receptors. Through these, thrombin activates the platelets. So also ADP activates the platelets, and this leads to further aggregation and activation of platelets, and this is known as recruitment. Next is, now these activated platelets, they produce thromboxane A2. These activated platelets produce thromboxane A2, and this is a potent aggregator of platelets. Now aspirin, what is the action of aspirin? It blocks the enzyme cyclooxygenase, and cyclooxygenase is required for the production of thromboxane A2. Thus, it has antiplatelet effect. It prevents the aggregation of platelets. Fourth step is platelet aggregation. When platelets undergo shape change, there is conformational change in the glycoprotein 2B3A receptor, and this increases its affinity for fibrinogen. And this fibrinogen then acts as a bridge between two platelets, two adjacent platelets, and this leads to aggregation of platelets. Now the deficiencies of glycoprotein 1B, inherited deficiency, it can lead to Bernard-Soulier syndrome. These are all bleeding disorders. And the deficiency of glycoprotein 2B3A, it leads to Glanzmann thrombocythemia. And deficiency of von Willebrand factor leads to von Willebrand disease. So these are important entities. In the next video, we will be studying about clotting factors and the role of endothelium in hemostasis. I hope you like the video. For more such videos, please subscribe my channel and do not forget to like and share my videos. Thanks for watching.